Human resource management on BCTV is supported by Mosteller and Associates.
My name is Audra. I'm a director of human resources with a local manufacturing company. I joined the Schermbergs chapter in 2000. Since then, I have taken the certification class and earned my SCP, which is a senior certified professional, through Sherm National. Additionally, I have served as a board member, going through as secretary, treasurer, vice president, and eventually president of the Sherm board. I have met many friends, colleagues, and associates who have assisted and guided me in my development as an HR professional. Joining Sherm adds value and recognition to your title as an HR person. And I strongly recommend joining our Schermbergs chapter.
Of tonight's show, human resource management. Our title topic tonight is employee performance management. We are live tonight, Tuesday, July 9th, 2019. It's our 14th year bringing you these live programs on various topics related to human resource management and business in general. As I said, we're live. 610-378-0426 is the number for home viewers to call in with your questions and comments. I'd like to thank our underwriter, Mosteller & Associates. They're a full-service professional HR consulting firm. They assist organizations of all sizes with any and all types of human resource management needs. You can find Chet and his team out there at 2433 Morgantown Road, near Green Hills, the Reading 19607 zip code. The telephone number is 610-779-3870, and we will show that information again for you later. We'll also show at the bottom of the program how you can reach us with our administrative director at the Berks County chapter, and you'll be able to reach out to us if you're interested in attending a meeting as a guest and checking us out. A disclaimer, as you saw at the top of the program, nothing here is meant to be legal advice, and the opinions of the panelists are their own and not necessarily those of their employers or of BCTV. Putting the housekeeping aside, we'd like to mention also, we are brought to you tonight live at the studios on the beautiful campus of Albright College. The BCTV studios here are a real gem in our community. And if you get online to bctv.org, there's an online streaming of these programs. This particular program is replayed Friday at 8 p.m., Saturday at 1 p.m., and Wednesday at 9 a.m., as well as live tonight at 6 p.m. So no matter what shift you're working, you can listen to us, you can learn a little bit, and on live programs have an opportunity to call in. We're also on YouTube, which means we're international. So it's quite an accomplishment, and it's all brought to you by the volunteers at BCTV, so please do support them. I'd like to introduce the panel tonight, and then they'll each give you their take on the value of the society, the National Society, and the Berks County chapter. And to my far left is Mr. Steve Bell. He's a vice president of HR, and to my in between Lou and Steve is Missy Forry, and she actually took her bachelor's degree right here on campus. It's kind of like homecoming for you, and she also has her senior certified professional from Sherm, as I believe Mr. Bell does.
Yes.
Yes. And to my immediate left here is Mr. Lew McCoy, and he's the director of HR and. Known everybody here on the panel for quite some time. All are members, and most of us have been officers at one time or another in the chapter. Steve, why don't you start it off, and who can join Berks County Chapter 179? What's this all about?
So the chapter is actually a part of SHRM National, and it brings together HR professionals in the community and people who want to advance their career in human resources. It's a great place to network with other HR practitioners, also develop your skills as an HR professional and stay current with what's happening in the field. So it's a great opportunity for people to get involved, not only in HR, but in the community as well.
Thank you. Missy, how about you?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a lot of, to add to what Steve had said, a lot of opportunity for resources, training resources, current events, kind of staying in tune with what's happening in the just in the field and in general, especially with the national SHRM as well as the local SHRM. There's just a ton of, again, resources, lots of training opportunities. You can always stay. It's just a great way to stay current with what's happening in the human resources field and law.
Yeah, great. And Lou, I know you've been up through the chain of command at least one time.
I think one and a half times.
One and a half times.
It's been a great experience. Been a long-term member of the society and have gained a lot of knowledge and experience, and also made a lot of friends and peers that I can call on, whether it's issues related to compensation or benefits or legal issues. You know, it's one thing to have the body of knowledge, which is a great resource relative to SHRM National. It's sort of another thing in terms of applying it in specific workplace situations. So being able to call peers that have been through similar kind of experiences is invaluable.
The Society for Human Resource Management, it's a national organization, probably has a quarter of a million members. Actually, it's international. They're probably in about 50 different countries. The Berks County chapter is an affiliate, an official affiliate of the national organization. We do hold our meetings every month, the second Tuesday, at the Berkshire Country Club. And it is open to members and guests who are sponsored by a member. And we have lunch and learn sessions as well. Every meeting qualifies. We have speakers that qualify us for professional development credits. And we also just put on a conference down at the DoubleTree downtown on diversity and inclusion. We also sponsor a student chapter over at Alvernia University. So as you can see, we do try to give back to the community while staying in touch with our own profession. And you don't have to have HR or personnel in your job title. You could be a small business owner and you're still responsible for all the HR laws and regulations for the most part that we all are, except maybe, you know, if you don't have enough people for FMLA or something. But don't fool yourself that because you're small, you don't have HR responsibilities because you do. So check us out, and you'll be able to contact us with the information at the bottom of the show if you're interested. So let's move on to our topic, employee performance management. We chose this topic mainly because we haven't touched on it in this particular global of an issue for some time now. And it's not just performance appraisal, it's not just discipline, it really covers a broader subject. So what we're going to do is take employee performance management from 30,000 feet and we'll drill down into some more specifics. So Missy, you want to start us off with what's your definition of just the topic itself and where do we go from here with it?
Sure, absolutely. Performance management, the way I look at it, is it's an ongoing, consistent process. It's not just a once-and-done conversation. So really starting from the very beginning, setting very clear expectations for your staff, and just continuing to have those ongoing conversations, consistently giving regular feedback. Again, it's not a once-and-done conversation. Some people think of performance appraisal, it's an annual process, that's your conversation, and that's your performance management, and that's really not... from my perspective, and where I work at Karen, that's not necessarily how we approach it. It's definitely regular conversations, so people know kind of where they stand in the process with their job performance and expectations.
Great. And Steve, how about you? Your definition?
Well, it's interesting, and I echo what you say, Missy, and take it a step back. It really starts with creating clear expectations for our employees. And so from the day they enter the door is making sure that their employee understands and knows what the expectations of them are on the job. Mm-hmm. And if they do that well, then that process you talk about in the regular feedback centers all around those expectations, and the feedback comes back to the employees so they know where they stand and how well they're doing, meeting the expectations that are needed for the organization to be successful.
Lou?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think a lot of people have the notion that it's a once a year kind of experience that many people don't especially look forward to, juxtaposed to, I think, what in a lot of organizations that are developing really best management practices around continuous, frequent communications about the employee, about their own development, their goals, what kind of needs they have, underlined again with establishing the expectations of the position, communicating what those expectations are, measuring them, and having feedback about that.
What do you think the role of performance management is, employee performance management? What do you think the role is for the organization in terms of its ability to compete, its ability to attract and retain with the tight labor markets? Where does that fit in?
Do you want me to take it?
Go for it.
All right. It's a good question, especially now when the job labor market is so tight. We're all competing kind of for the same employee base at this point. There's many more jobs than what there are talent at this moment. So how do you compete in that space, and how do you use performance management? And you know, we were kind of talking before the show about some people are even hesitant to address any performance issues because they don't want to lose that talent. So addressing it from a company perspective, one, I think, is, you know, retaining talent to begin with, and what does that look like, and then layering in the performance management part of that. So what's your focus on retaining talent? Is it compensation in your benefits package? Is it your culture? Is it the combination of all of it? You know, why does somebody want to stay there to begin with? And then making sure that you're following through on what that philosophy is to begin with through the performance management process, that you're holding people accountable to those standards.
And you, all three companies are, we can say, pretty safely in the private sector. I don't know where Karen fits in that whole spectrum, but so we don't have county government, state government, and those kinds of systems in place in your companies, of course. And you have a wide diversity of talent. You've got executives, you've got professionals, scientists, medical professionals. Then you have people maybe in blue-collar jobs. You might have production workers, shift workers. How many different employee management, performance management systems, what's the secret with keeping all those wheels working in sync?
Well, I think, Bob, the first thing that's most important is that an organization recognizes it's really starts at the relationship between the employee and their manager. And as I said earlier, creating the expectation, but then having the communication and that feedback loop that says, hey, this is what's important for our business. This is why we have you here. This is the impact you make on the business. And then utilizing that as a tool to motivate people, to keep them focused, and to perform at a high level. Because quite frankly, if they do, the benefit is the organization does better. Right. And so whose responsibility is that to make sure each employee performs at that high level? It's the supervisor. So it's really important that we don't look at performance management as just a process. It really is an everyday activity that's ultimately the responsibility of every supervisor or anybody who has people reporting to them to make sure these people are engaged and focused on the right things for the business.
So we're seeing training which is in HR's wheelhouse, we see training as a critical component before you can even get to performance management. You have to have the people who are doing the managing trained in the right tools to do that. How do you work it? You just recently revised some of your program,
yeah,
didn't you, Lou?
We did. We revamped our program just several years ago. And we started the process by eliciting feedback from our employees about the current, what was then the current program, what they liked about it, what they didn't like about.
Can you share any of that? That sounds terribly intriguing.
Yeah.
were you a little hesitant about it? Maybe we shouldn't ask that
one? Yeah, they wanted honest feedback. They wanted frequent feedback. They didn't want kid gloves, but they wanted expectations that were clearly articulated. What they didn't want was sort of a check-the-box rote kind of process that had become sort of the norm over a number of years. So I think just by virtue of sort of updating the process a bit, making it more of a two-way conversation with the managers, and having really a focus on coaching the employees as opposed to overlooking, you know, and scoring them, am I a 5 or a 7 or a 10 and so forth.
Yeah, what does that mean? You know, it's just, and then, well, I gave them a 7 last year, I can't give them anything less than that this year, you know,
right.
So you have grade creep.
Right.
Gosh.
So one of the things that we, a little bit later on through the process, we did for all of our leadership team help refine and develop the plan. And we involved the managers in terms of training them and training the employees. So you were asking earlier, like, what's the definition of performance management? So I took this one from SHRM. So process of maintaining and improving performance by way of using different assessment tools, coaching, and continuous feedback. The last two parts of that I like the best, and I think our employees appreciate that. So we do that twice a year.
Missy, Steve talked about the role of the aligned supervisor and the immediate managers. If you could comment on that, and then also the role of top management.
Sure. Any manager in a company is the one that's actually, you know, it's ultimately they're responsible for their employees. They're responsible for, they have a lot of responsibility lying on them, regardless if they're frontline supervisor or an executive. They're all responsible for making sure that the performance of their staff, everybody's being held accountable. There's just a lot that falls on their shoulders. So giving them the tools that they need, I think, is important from consistency. It doesn't matter if you're line supervisor or an executive. There's still a base kind of learning or set of expectations that you would want to make sure that you're providing to all employees at every level to make sure that they're giving their employees, again, that consistency. So what does onboarding look like? What is the, you know, what are your core values? And is everybody adhering to the core values the same way? So I think, again, it's that consistency of training, regardless, to me, again, regardless if it's line supervisors or executives. Executives, again, they might be holding people to a different level of accountability because of their roles in the organization of who they're supervising. But that's kind of...
So what I'm hearing is... of course, we have a very tight local labor market, tight pretty much everywhere, I guess, but you've heard the phrase, hire hard, manage easy. but when you can't hire, how's that being impacted? How's that concept being impacted on an employee management, performance management system, which not many people like? Managers think it's a burden. Employees think it's arbitrary. Managers don't like me, whatever. How do we fit employee performance management into that? Geez, how does that, it's a tight labor market. Everybody's working, you know, where do you get people? And even if you get them, they already have a job and you can't afford them. It's just, where do you go with this? How do you solve this, Lou?
It is a challenge with having a tight labor market and finding people and retaining people. We're very fortunate in the sense that our average tenure is almost 14 years, and we have a retention of about 90%. At the same time, bringing new talent in, I think, is really important for organizations at all levels. But what I think is helped us is our culture and a focus on values that we don't just think or things or just signs that we put up on a wall somewhere, that we really do live by them through our actions and words. So, you know, integrity and teamwork and quality and customer service are the four core values that we have, and we call each other on it. If somebody's, you know, sort of deviating from that, and sometimes they're tough conversations to have, but if you do it in the right way, maybe add a little bit of humor to it, it reinforces those values.
Not as strong as shunning, but it works, right?
Yes.
And Missy, I wonder if you...
I'm sorry.
No, please.
Lew, I think what's interesting is you touched on something, is trying to find, you know, where people's strengths are and what they do well and valuing those good things. And okay, so they're straying, and it's not just the manager's responsibility. It's kind of the group, the team's responsibility to help people stay on course.
Right.
And to really leverage the strengths of people. And Bob, that's really what we're challenged with, is that, you know, when the labor market is tight, you really take some extra time to make sure that you're utilizing the skills of the people you have most effectively. And that's part of the performance management and the development process, is to look at where people's strengths are and how can you leverage those strengths to the benefit of the organization. And if they're not in the right job, maybe they need to be in another job, or to help guide them or give them the training so they can be productive workers for you, because there aren't a lot of choices out there. And so you're hiring sometimes on potential and working with people so that they can benefit your organization in the ways that you need.
Right. And how do you leverage the team to help you support that?
Exactly.
That way the manager yourself isn't being taxed with all that.
Missy, I wonder if you could talk to the one of the key system components to any employee management program begins actually with, I would argue it begins with a well-written essential functions / job description. Again, directly in HR's wheelhouse, but could you talk to the contribution of the well-written description with essential functions and competencies in this whole process?
Right, absolutely. We talked in the beginning about setting clear expectations. To me, the job description is the first step in being able to set what those clear expectations are. So when you talk about the essential functions, because, you know, you don't necessarily want a 20-page document at the end of the day, but the high level, here are the true essential functions in a very clear manner. So when I am hired into a role, I can look at the job description and have a pretty solid understanding of what my role is going to be. I think that's one of the, to your point, Bob, that's one of the first steps in performance management. I think the other part that's tied to that, though, and Lew had alluded to that earlier, around the core values. Yeah. You know, what are your values? And including that in your performance management process. It's not necessarily just about the competency as far as your job, but also holding true to the values of the organization.
Yeah. It's interesting. It's not just the what. And I think sometimes when we think of job descriptions, it's a task list. As opposed, you know, in the mechanics of what you do versus what do we really need you to achieve? What do we need you to accomplish? How do we expect you to do that? You know, 30 years ago, that's what job descriptions were task lists. Mm-hmm. Looking at that differently, to your point, can make a real difference in how we manage people's performance, because now they get it, and whether it's values and the culture, it's now about how and what our expectations are in and around how the job is performed, the end result, as opposed to checking a task off a list.
Right.
Yeah, the behavior that's part of performing.
Well, I can tell you that several years ago, we converted our job descriptions to basically essential functions. And then within each essential function, there were one, two, or three standards or goals that had to be met to meet that essential function. And as you know, there's no law requiring you to have a job description. There are laws requiring you to know the essential functions and the competencies. Mm-hmm. So we made that shift. And in healthcare, at the cancer center, most everybody's touching the patient. In fact, I have five essential functions. Nobody else has more than four, but it serves us well, because we can build our performance appraisal tool right based on those competencies and those standards and goals for those essential functions. So it's kind of an extension of it, and it works in that milieu. I don't know if it works in other environments or not, but I'm wondering if you could talk about just the sheer job description development process you're using, and maybe there's people out there saying, I still have task lists, I'm gonna pay attention right now, you know?
So I know that what we try to do in ours is we still have the list, right? However, the way the list is written is a lot different than it was before. And so now it is, incorporating the behaviors, the how, to accomplish something. So if you're in customer service, it's not entering orders, but it's talking about how you respond to a customer's needs, and the expectation is built into the description in and around competencies and behaviors. So that's one of the things. It's interesting because I've worked in many different places. I've seen a lot of people do some pretty creative things with job descriptions, and Bob, I think keeping it simple and four or five things and get the idea of, all right, what's critical for you to do?
The operative word's essential.
That's right. Yeah. And be able to describe that for people. It gets them going, because the tasks change with technology and all the changes that are going on in our businesses. We're updating job descriptions constantly. And so, the days of the task list are gone, because as soon as you write them, something's changed, and the next week it's out of date. And so I know we've taken an approach to be more holistic in driving what the desired outcome is, more so than the task.
I like the other point that you made with that, Steve, that I think is a good one, is talking about results and behavior as opposed to things that are so difficult to describe. What's attitude, It's like you can measure results and you can assess behavior, but attitude's one of the things I try to avoid when
Eliminate it from people. Your vocabulary, yes. That's right. It just gets you in trouble.
Exactly.
And I think, again, it's the same thing. It's an overall concept. I like the word holistic approach, because jobs are going to be ever evolving. The technology is ever evolving. So really just honing in, trying to be, sometimes the shorter the job description, the more time it takes to develop it, because you actually have to be thoughtful about the process, right? Like you have to be very clear and concise, and that's forcing us to do that. So I think the more time that we can actually pay attention to what are those critical essential functions and kind of honing in on that, it's important.
Yeah, we're in the second half of the hour tonight, we'll talk more about the actual performance appraisal, performance evaluation tools, which are always vexing for HR. But I'm wondering, how on earth do you use your employee performance management program with workers that maybe aren't on site? Maybe they're mobile workers, maybe they're remote workers, maybe they're third shift and nobody's working except a team or something. How do you handle that situation where they're not visible, they're not evident? Quality, quantity standards? I mean, the system's not built for them, the system's built for everybody during the day.
And I think we have a lot of offsite staff. And so, again, to me, it's the same process that we use for the onsite staff that you're using for the offsite staff. So it's still, and if not connecting with them, even more so. So when I say about regular check-ins and regular feedback and ongoing conversations, it's probably even more so with offsite staff. I can walk down the hall and check in with somebody. I have to be really thoughtful and mindful about picking up the phone and calling that offsite staff and making sure that we're scheduling time for that regular check-in and feedback. And who are they working with offsite, and can you get feedback from them, from the individuals that they're working with, so you know kind of what their job performance is like?
I think we're going to take a break right now and catch another one of those testimonials that we have from one of our members. And when we come back, we'll dig right into the different types of performance appraisal tools. My name is Bob, and I've been involved in the human resource management profession for over 40 years. I've been a member of the Society for Human Resource Management, which is an internationally recognized professional association with superior tools and resources for the human resource profession. I'm also a member of the Berks County chapter, an affiliate of the Society, and we have approximately 200 members, many of whom, over half of whom, are certified professionally through one of the multiple agencies that authorize that on an international basis. The local chapter is a real value proposition for anyone in the human resource field or any executive or principal of a company responsible for human assets. We have regular monthly meetings, presentations on a professional basis by qualified individuals. We provide certification credits. We are also engaged in the community through producing and hosting a one-hour television program on a local cable BCTV program, and we address HR issues there in a live audience participating format. We also provide community engagement through conferences that we organize, and we also offer a holiday dinner for local youth groups. I would encourage anyone out there with any type of responsibility for human resources or the company's success in general to consider becoming a member of the local chapter and certainly of the Society for Human Resource Management, because their tools and solutions are available to all members and they're very timely. Thank you. And here we are back live tonight, Tuesday, July 9th, in the studios on the beautiful campus of Albright College, BCTV. 610-378-0426 is the call-in number for those of you out there in BCTV viewing land. So the second half of this program, we're going to jump into the actual construct and application and designs of different performance management tools, performance appraisal systems, if you will. In the first half, we heard a couple of words constantly come out: credibility, clear expectations, values, engagement, and all appropriate and certainly necessary, and certainly very difficult to maintain on a day-to-day basis. Sometimes the tools that are developed in the profession make that even harder, not easier, because now you have to sell a system to employees who might not buy into it. You might have to spend extra time training managers in a new system who didn't like the old one, and the new one's harder to learn. But we have to have tools. Mechanics have tools, accountants have tools, HR has performance management tools. Lou, you want to talk about yours first? Do you have different types, category rating scales, narrative, MBO? What do you got?
Sure. So we have all that. We tried to make it concise and as simple as possible, but as meaningful as possible as well. So we start with sort of just basic information of what their position is, and then we have what the next potential progression that they might have. So if, as an example, they're a graduate engineer, we have lots of engineers. So if they're a graduate engineer, then the next level might be senior graduate engineer, and then when they get their professional engineer's license, a project engineer. And then we have success factors or key performance indicators that exist in any role for firms like ours, similar to perhaps accounting or the legal profession. Direct hours or billable hours are an important metric. Very broadly stated, what we are trying to measure is our projects getting done on time, within budget, and most importantly, are the clients satisfied with what we're doing? So getting our arms around that through key performance indicators that are related to, again, direct hours as well as client satisfaction.
These are just for engineers?
For all of our staff.
All staff.
Yeah. And again, client, whether that's an internal client that an employee is working with to produce a product for a client, or an external client, or some of the KPIs. So that's sort of the first part of it. And then we get into accomplishments that were achieved. We do this twice a year. And we give them tools to try to jog the memory of the, in some cases, hundreds of projects that people have worked on during the course of, mm-hmm. of the year. And then obstacles or roadblocks or resources is a big section of the conversation, which is memorialized by way of the review. So trying to improve ourselves as an organization and improve employee development by addressing rocks or things that are getting in their way are sort of the three main parts of our review.
And we'll get back later to the role of compensation and how, if anything, these systems are tied to rewards of some sort. Missy, how about out there at the vastness of Karen on the Hill?
Sure. When we developed our performance appraisal system, or first of all, developing the performance appraisal questions and what's in it, we also did employee feedback as well to create that process. Very simple though. The feedback was, I don't want to spend, want it to be meaningful. Again, what's, don't want to spend a ton of time though, as far as answering 10 questions. Question number 5 might be very similar to question number 3. I'm repeating myself. So being very succinct with, again, what are, focusing on what our values are, focusing on the job specific competencies and rating somebody's competent. Also then development, what are the areas for development? What are the, you know, what are the strengths? And so again, very short and sweet. And then the goals, of course, is a huge part of that. What are your goals for the next year? Setting those, and then in the previous year, and the next year, you're gonna, you know, rate how well you did on those goals, and those goals are usually set to obviously the company's goals for the year. And we do all of that in our, we have an HRS system, so it's all in the same system that we use for timekeeping and everything else.
So you're leveraging the technology to at least ease the pain somewhat.
That's right, yeah, so it's one system that everybody's logging into, they're familiar with it. Instead, we used to have multiple systems and that was a nightmare for people. Can't remember their passwords, but I mean, it's just, it becomes very cumbersome and inefficient. So narrowing that down to one software was helpful for us.
You'll have to, off camera, you'll have to tell me about the system because I've looked at several and they're all over the board.
Yeah.
But Steve, how about you?
Well, and I will tell you that we found it when we went to an automated system, just like Missy described, where it was integrated with our HRIS, it became a lot easier and people liked it a lot better because they were familiar with the screens and the way to go in and access. So we found we received a lot of good feedback when we implemented that. It is easier, and our components are very similar to yours, objectives, goals and objectives, set the prior year, evaluated on, a lot of them centered around KPIs, depending on the job. And then we identified competencies that are required in our environment that we would like people to have in and around if you're in a leadership role, if you're in an individual contributor role, if you're in an administrative role. And so we as a group identified key competencies that we think are important to demonstrate success in those types of positions. And then also looking at development goals, so very similar to yours. The challenges, and Lou, I think you're the memory joggers, right? You put something in to help people remind, I mean, that's a challenge.
Right.
And our system allows people to go in and if they have a conversation with somebody, log that in or put an update on a goal as the year goes on as a memory jogger, but still it requires them to log in. And that's a discipline that people just don't have, and it's tough to develop.
Any of them have voice recognition software capability?
I don't know.
When the doctors are dictating into the electronic medical records, they're not typing.
No.
And of course, the problem there is differentiating between saline and saline for somebody whose English isn't the primary language, you know. But anyway, I just didn't know if everything's keyboarded or...
One of the things about, we don't have that, but what I started encouraging managers to do is, often you get an email on something that was done well. Hey, I just closed this sale. Or, hey, we just implemented and accomplished this goal. And I always tell them, write the thank you. Respond to that email. Do it in an email form and save it. Keep a folder in your email that says that person's name and pop it in there so that when you go to do the annual review, if that's the process, you can always look back. Whenever you have to give feedback, you can go back, good, bad, and indifferent. A lot of feedback is given by email. So just create that file folder and put it over, and that is a memory jogger that we're using. I don't know what you guys are using, but it seems to work for some managers pretty well.
We actually have electronic systems, so Word document, whatever's the email, but supervision agendas. So every time somebody comes to supervision, they're bringing an agenda, so hopefully some of those things are highlighted. And again, saving those and looking back through those throughout the course of the year too.
Right. So it's important to do this stuff right. It's important to be straightforward, to be clear expectations. These same things keep coming up. With these documents that are created, do employees get a copy of them?
Well, I mean, absolutely.
It's in their file, sure. But there's different schools of thought on employees can always see their records. They can make notes from them, but the law doesn't necessarily require you to give them copies of anything. But just a side question.
Well, that's the nice thing of having it in the HRS. I don't know about your system, mm-hmm. but they have access. They can see it any time, and they also put their comments in as well.
You use DocuSign, so they sign things.
Yeah, there's an electronic signature, and so we have.
And if
that
they
record.
Disagree with something, maybe they can put rebuttals in.
Exactly, and we allow them to do that. They have access to that.
Again, credibility component. You know, right. It's everything's transparent. May not like it, but here it is, and so the trust level rises. They might not like it, but the trust is there,
right.
Which is a critical component of these things.
Can I add another feature?
Please.
That we use, and the system definitely allows us to do this, is 360 feedback. So that's one of the items, especially for our leadership team mm-hmm. or those in management. Again, they do have a different process, different performance appraisal as far as what they're rated on. But then that same appraisal goes out to their subordinates or colleagues, peers, whatever that looks like, and getting their feedback. That's anonymous. So then how do you know?
Oh, it's anonymous.
It's anonymous. So you can incorporate that into, you know, the supervisor can read the feedback and, you know, choose to incorporate what they want into the performance appraisal process. But I think it's always nice, especially for leaders. You're not necessarily side by side working with them all the time. So getting feedback from what others think of their performance, you know, is it in line with yours or not? Or is there something surprising in there that you may not have known about? So,
well, two of the standards for any test in HR course, the words reliability and validity. When it's anonymous, how do you reconcile that with validity, given the propensity for people to be human, and there are a lot of error ratings that are potential, halo effect, horn effect, recency effect, those kinds of things. Mm-hmm. How'd you get past that and reconcile all those moving parts?
Yeah, I think for us it's kind of... go ahead.
Oh, excuse me. We have a home viewer. Yes, can I have your first name, please?
Hello, my name is Peter. I have some comments for the lady with the white jacket. Is it important to speak Spanish for certain positions, and does that mean that I will receive a higher salary if I speak Spanish and I'll do good in the workplace?
So it's a good question. So the question's around, basically, again, is it important for certain roles? Like Karen, I'm assuming you're speaking directly about to speak Spanish. Certain roles, it's not necessarily a requirement or an essential function. It's helpful. We definitely don't have a preference one way or the other. If somebody does, we do use that though. If we have Spanish speaking patients. And then the compensation, again, because it's not necessarily a requirement of the job, so the compensation is not necessarily, that won't necessarily make a difference as far as if it's a higher compensation or not.
Great. Okay. Peter, thank you for your question. We haven't gotten to the issue of compensation yet as it relates to performance appraisal ratings or scorings or anything like that. But in the time we have left, we should touch on that eventually. We were talking about the rating errors and how to reconcile, because 360-degree performance appraisals are one of many kinds. And there's behaviorally anchored rating scales and management by objective and narrative form. There's all kinds of formats depending on the HR and the company's level of sophistication or technology use or whatever, and you know, forced choice, and not everybody can be a five. Well, if our training worked and our selection process worked and our recruiting process worked, eventually everybody can be a five. So the forced choice I always thought was kind of bogus in that sense. But 360 seems to come and go every several years in the system. And on the surface, it's really powerful. But it's almost Stalin-esque in a way, where people are behaving not because they adhere to the values or the standards, but because they're afraid of what people will say about them and it'll hurt their raise. Right. I'm just saying, there's so much with it, but it really is a powerful tool, no question. Mm-hmm. But in the time we have left here, how do you relate compensation to whatever that performance appraisal tool has told you about a person? Do you come up with a score or a rating, or is it that? Or how do you relate the two? Or don't you relate them at all?
So we keep ours fairly simple. We've in the past had variations of it. So is somebody exceeding? Is somebody performing? Is somebody developing? Or is somebody in a correcting mode? So there's sort of the four categories that we
You're doing great. Assess. You're making it. You're not making it.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Okay.
For us, we've also, again, depending on the how somebody is rated throughout, there is a calculation of an overall score at the end that's automatically calculated based on how the system's built. And we have used that to kind of as a baseline for if somebody falls within a certain score, then they're eligible for a certain increase. And again, it's a broad range of an increase. It's not just set in stone that your score equals this, your performance, you know, your merit increase equals this. So there is still a little
bit of... In the bottom third of the range, you get more than if you're at the top third. Yeah.
It's, yeah.
Okay.
We're not that scientific about it. And one of the things that we want to make sure is the conversation regarding performance is really about performance and what's going on. It's a data point in the compensation decision in question, but there are a lot of other factors that we look at when we look at somebody's compensation. So we do a salary review, and one consideration is their performance, but then also what is the market for their particular job? Where are they relative to the market? So do we need to make any adjustments, or where do we find them to be in an adequate pay level for the job they're doing? And so sometimes it's, you know, people have a significant accomplishment, so you want to give them more. Other people, and Lew, we have people who are key contributors, and so we look at all those factors when determining whether or not somebody should get an increase or how much they should get.
You bring up a great point, and we educate our managers and employees relative to compensation and how we do look at it from an internal perspective, just to see. I'm a twin, but there's no identical twin in the workplace, so to speak. So, but we do look internally to make sure there's some parity or fairness where one person is relative to another in terms of positions. And from an external perspective, what our clients are willing to pay for the services that we provide as a service organization, or billing rates, so to speak, mm-hmm. drive it, and obviously the labor market and various positions.
Yeah. We do have, as you said, there are no two employees alike, and performances vary. There are going to be marginal employees for one reason or another, and sometimes you don't want to let people go in this labor market, but you want to use the appraisal format there not to determine pay, not to make them feel good with a enhanced appraisal. Sometimes you have to use it as a developmental tool as well. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you could each chat a little bit about that concept. You've got skill sets, you got competencies, and now you got a skill gap. What do you do? What's the intervention now?
I think addressing that as soon as you're identifying it. Right. You know, how are you identifying?
Not waiting for the every 6 month
That's
review.
Right. Yeah, it's not waiting for that annual process or whatever. Mm-hmm. Again, it's that ongoing, consistent, and addressing it in the moment, because the longer you wait, the worse it's going to get. The person, and then you're going to. You know,
why didn't you tell me sooner?
Catch the person off guard. Yeah, why didn't you tell me this before? I've been doing it for how long now? Now you're just telling me. And the longer you wait, the bigger of a problem it's going to become for you as the supervisor.
So have you had to be involved in that, or are you training the managers to be good at feedback that may be not so glowing? How does that work?
Well, remember, there's a gap, right? And so all you're doing is you're encouraging your supervisors to, A, identify the gap. Sometimes it's difficult to do. And then B, take some action to bridge that gap. And it's situation specific. What is that gap? And then what? And have we made sure that we give the person the feedback on what it is that they're not, how they're not meeting the expectation, or they're doing something that is concerning, and then working with them to understand why that gap exists. Do not make an assumption. So that's the first thing we tell the supervisor. Don't assume you know why there's that gap. Right. And involve the employee in understanding it and then solving it. Because ultimately, the employee needs to do something differently, and it's really the manager figuring out and working with the employee to create that awareness and help them figure out a way to change whatever needs to be changed.
And I think how it's framed to the employees, it really makes a difference. You're using words that sound more like coaching the employee on factual kinds of things, as opposed to, you know, the person. It's not the person, it's the behavior, and how can you focus on looking forward as opposed to dwelling on the past, I think.
How do you know they're not an undiagnosed diabetic? And that's a lot of the same symptoms of somebody who's alcohol dependent. Mm-hmm. And you don't know, and they were a good employee at one time, and now they're not so good, and now they're less so good and consistently. But we're dealing with real people here, and each one's going to be a little different, and it's a real challenge. In the time we have left, if each of you could move now to the less pleasant side of the performance management spectrum, where when does it go from coaching and counseling to using this, not as a weapon, but now it becomes almost discipline? Does that ever happen?
All the time, unfortunately. You know, and the idea is you're trying to cut it off. But it's no different than, you know, I look at it as raising children, right? When you're working to change behavior, you know, there's a consequence eventually. And so if you're coaching all along and you're encouraging, but the behavior continues to repeat itself, yeah, at some point you need to draw the line and say, and point that out. And as Lou said, it's fact-based. It's not personal, it's fact-based. The same behavior is being demonstrated over and over again. And if it continues, you need to know that this isn't working for us anymore. We can't allow it to continue.
But it's a tight labor market, the pressure. Yeah,
right. It is. It's the balance you choose.
Sure.
But then, what's the impact on the business?
Right.
And so
tie it to business.
It really does. Is that gap and that concern more costly than going without a person and filling that position for a period of time? And are there other ways you can bridge that gap even without that person? So they're not easy decisions or situations to address.
Yeah. Okay. Missy, you got a moment here. Let's hear from you about the less positive side of all this.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I agree with Steve as far as there is going to be that time where, okay, like what, you know, you are going to have to move through to the next step. So if you're not seeing improvement, again, being very clear and setting on in the facts, providing the facts, being very clear what the expectations are moving forward, and just holding people accountable to that. In the job market with it being tight, again, thinking about the business, how much time are you spending with that employee? If they weren't here, you might actually free up some of your time and be able to focus on some other things. You might be surprised at how quickly you can get your work done.
Great. Lou, all those engineers want to do well, so you don't have those kind of problems, do you?
Well, making people, Missy said, accountable, you know, and if you ignore it, other employees notice it probably before you even do it sometimes. So in the absence of taking some action, you might actually have other people that brings their performance down, or maybe even people that leave because of
credibility again. You've got to act. Well, in the time we have left, I'd like to take a moment to thank our panel here again tonight. Lew McCoy, Director of HR at Spot Stevens & McCoy. Missy Forry, the VP of HR at the Karen Foundation. And Mr. Steve Bell, VP of HR at Glengarry. Excellent panel and an excellent conversation. Thank you so much, and you're all welcome back anytime. And September 9th, I think, is the next one. We'd also like to thank the people behind the cameras here, the volunteers, At least they're volunteers today because they're not being paid. So there. It's Matt, Jordan, and Connor in the studio, in the engineering booth, and behind the cameras. But this is it's BCTV, and it's a great resource for our community. And mission is to enhance the unity and strength of us all by providing this medium of dialogue. If you look at their programming, there's something there for everybody. Last but not least, we want to thank our Society for Human Resource Management and our affiliate, Berks County Chapter 179, under whose auspices we bring you this program, as well as Chet Mosteller out there at Mosteller & Associates, the full-service professional HR consulting firm, our underwriter, whose generosity brings us this program to you. And certainly, at the bottom of the program, you will see not only another testimonial, but also how to reach out to our administrative director to inquire about the organization. You can see us on www.berkspa.shrm.org. So thank you very much, and we'll look for you in September. Good night.
Hi, my name's Debbie Ramsey. I'm the Human Resource and Client Service Manager at Gage Personnel. I'm also the immediate past president of our local chapter. I'd like to tell you 10 top reasons why you should join our chapter. We have excellent speakers and an opportunity to bring a guest to any of our meetings. We also offer convenient breakfast and lunch sessions, volunteer opportunities, a certification study group, a Pal Olivet's Feed a Friend dinner, which is a great time and a great way to spend the holidays. We have a BCTV show, a monthly legal update with our local attorney, discount to our local chapter if you're a national member, recertification credits, and personal development. Our Berks chapter is a valuable resource for employers and employees alike. In my opinion, we help make Berks County a best place to work. Thank you.
Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Mosteller & Associates.